Well, welcome. I'm so glad you joined me today, and you're listening to Asheville Free Media, and this is Living Well, a show that explores the many ways that we can live well in our lives. I'm your host, Dr. Bob Hanna, a psychologist and the founder of Integrative Therapy of Asheville, and I am honored to have the opportunity to introduce you to the amazing people who live in and around Asheville, who are living well in their lives and helping others to do the same. Living Well is underwritten by the West Village Market, located at 771 Haywood Road in the heart of West Asheville. West Village Market offers a deli bar with healthy sandwiches and soups, the Panther Moon Tea Bar, and the Pharmacy Juice and Tonic Bar. The market also carries fresh and local organic produce, an assortment of groceries and bulk foods, beer and wine, local products, as well as health and body care items. For more information, visit www.westvillagemarket.com. Well, it's just a beautiful day outside here in the Blue Ridge Mountains. I hope you all were able to get out into nature, or at least outside, and enjoy this wonderful, wonderful weather that we are having. And when we talk about the idea of living well in our lives, you know, you can do no better than getting to spend time in nature. And I imagine we're going to be talking about that with a little bit with our guest, Bloom Post, today, who will be joining me today in the Asheville Free Media Studios. But first, I wanted to take a moment and acknowledge a very, very special being who passed this past Wednesday, May 28th, 2014, Maya Angelou. And I decided I'd do a little bit of Wikipedia and research on her and learn a little bit more about Dr. Angelou's life. And she was born on April 4th, 1928, and she was raised in St. Louis and Stamps, Arkansas. And as you can imagine, during this time, she was right in the heart of living in the Deep South, of the brutality of racial discrimination. But she was also deeply influenced by her unshakable faith and values of the traditional African-American family, community, and culture. She earned a scholarship when she was a teenager to study dance and drama at San Francisco's Labor School, but ended up dropping out of school at the age of 14, and she became the first African-American female cable car conductor. I bet most of you didn't know that. And then she went on to finish high school, and then right after she graduated, she gave birth to her son, Guy. So she was actually a single mother at this point. And she supported herself by working as a waitress and a cook, but she never lost her passion for the arts and music, dance, and poetry. In her life, she published 7 autobiographies, 3 books of essays, and several books of poetry, and was credited with a list of plays, movies, and television shows spanning more than 50 years. She received dozens of awards and over 30 honorary doctoral degrees. Angelou is best known for her series, which focused on her childhood and early adult experiences. The first, I Know Why the Caged Bird Sings, she wrote in 1969, which tells of her life up to the age of 17, and this book brought her international recognition and acclaim. From 1982, she taught at Wake Forest University in Winston-Salem, North Carolina, where she held the first lifetime Reynolds Professorship of American Studies. She was active in the civil rights movement and worked with Martin Luther King Jr. and Malcolm X. In fact, it was her birthday was the day that Martin Luther King was assassinated. Beginning in the 1990s, she made around 80 appearances a year on the lecture circuit, something she continued into her 80s. In 1993, Angelou recited her poem, On the Pulse of Morning, at President Bill Clinton's inauguration, making her the first poet to make an inaugural recitation since Robert Frost did at John F. Kennedy's inauguration in 1961. So in honor of Maya Angelou, I'd like to read one of her poems, which is entitled, Still I Rise. You may write me down in history with your bitter, twisted lies. You may trod me in the very dirt, but still, like dust, I'll rise. Does my sassiness upset you? Why are you beset with gloom? 'Cause I walk like I've got oil wells pumping in my living room? Just like moons and like suns, with the certainty of tides, just like hopes springing high, still I'll rise. Did you want to see me broken? Bowed head and lowered eyes, shoulders falling down like teardrops, weakened by my soulful cries. Does my haughtiness offend you? Don't you take it awful hard, 'cause I laugh like I've got gold mines digging in my own backyard. You may shoot me with your words, you may cut me with your eyes, you may kill me with your hatefulness, but still, like air, I'll rise. Does my sexiness upset you? Does it come as a surprise that I dance like I've got diamonds at the meeting of my thighs? Out of the huts of history's shame I rise. Up from the past that's rooted in pain, I rise. I'm a black ocean, leaping and wide. Welling and swelling, I bear in the tide. Leaving behind nights of terror and fear, I rise. Into a daybreak that's wondrously clear, I rise. Bringing the gifts that my ancestors gave, I am the dream and the hope of the slave. I rise, I rise, I rise. Maya Angelou. Thank you, Maya, for all the wonderful, wonderful gifts that you've given to humanity. You will be dearly missed. Wow, that poem just gives me chills. What a beautiful, beautiful words. Well, with that said, I'd love to go ahead and announce my guest today, Bloom Post. Bloom is a shamanic, intuitive healer, author, and ordained shamanic minister who lives in the mountains of western North Carolina, not far from Asheville. She is the author of the book Shaman's Toolbox, Practical Tools for Powerful Transformation. Bloom has studied across the U.S. and India, and some of her teachers have included an Appalachian shaman, a Native American elder, Buddhist monks and nuns, as well as Hindu swamis and gurus. A Reiki master teacher, she also received her yoga teacher training certification in India in 2005. And you can learn more about Bloom and her services at her website, www.bloompost.com. Bloom, welcome to Living Well.
Thank you, Bob. It's a pleasure to be here. Thank you for that beautiful opening about Maya Angelou. I love that poem. Thank you.
Had you heard it before?
Oh, yes.
Yes.
It's very famous, I would imagine, to everybody.
Yes.
She was amazing.
Yes.
Yeah, thank you.
Well, I wanted to start off giving you an opportunity to share a little bit about your life experiences that have led you to this work that you're doing in the world today. You know, were the seeds of this present in your childhood growing up?
Oh, yes, definitely. Maybe not as dramatic as Maya Angelou's story. However, the seeds of my childhood definitely have grown into my adulthood and brought me to where I am. And the challenges of my childhood really ended up opening me up in a way that I was very empathic and very intuitive. I had a traumatic experiences when I was very young that really started me on a path of seeking healing.
Mm-hmm.
And I feel that that's what brought me finally to shamanism. I went down a lot of different paths, which is why I've been to a lot of different places and studied with different teachers and learned so many wonderful things. And for me, when I finally sat with the first person that I felt is a shaman, the first person that I'd met and studied with, it felt expansive enough the energy and the ideas and the creativity. The container of shamanism to me feels very big and expansive.
Yes.
And allows for a lot of imagination. So it was the first time I found a journey that resonated that I really felt called to continue and study with. And what brought me to it was a path of healing.
Mm-hmm. So it really resonated and kind of it just lit up this part within yourself that it was just, it just felt like the path for you.
Yes, and there's times when I think I'm just going to walk away and do something completely different. And, you know, it's
yes.
Chop wood, carry water. It's a lot of work to be on the path when we're devoted to something, and I still absolutely love it, and I'm so grateful that I came back to these energies that feel so resonant for me in this journey.
And so what time in your life was that you connected with a shamanic teacher?
I didn't connect with a teacher until I was probably 29. When I was about 19, I read a book by Maladoma Somme.
Mm-hmm.
It's the story of his life. He's an African shaman, amazing teacher who's still alive and teaches today.
He has a lot of students here
area. He's amazing. And I read it and it didn't click. And then about 6 years later, I read it again, not realizing that I'd already read it, and remembered about halfway through, wait, I've read this. And that's when I started reading more and diving more into shamanism from many different cultures. And when I was probably 29, I met what I would refer to as an Appalachian shaman. His
yes.
mother was a seer. His grandmother was a seer. That's what they called themselves, and taught him about the plants and the natural world and really taught him what he knew. And
was that in the Native American tradition then?
No, it really was. I just call it an Appalachian tradition because his mother and grandmother and great-grandmother, he has a long history in these mountains, and they learned from the land and they shared with him.
Yes.
So I began to sit with him because I was seeking healing, and I needed some context for what I was experiencing. Ever since I was a child, I had the ability to know things that nobody had told me, and I could see things, and I could see dead people. I was like the little kid in The Sixth Sense or something.
Mm-hmm.
Fortunately, not that bizarre, but it was bizarre enough that no one could explain to me what was going on.
Yes.
Or give me any context. So as I got older, I didn't know what to do with my intuitive abilities, my empathic abilities, my abilities to see into the realms. And it wasn't until I sat with this shaman that someone finally said, oh, these are gifts. This isn't a curse. This is a good thing. Let me show you how to work with it. And he did that.
Yes. So, you know, I think there's a lot of misunderstanding about what shamanism is,
mm-hmm.
you know, and
mm-hmm.
I'm just curious how you've come to understand and define what shamanism is.
That's a great question, and one that I often just tell people to Google it. defining shamanism, there's such a big conversation there, and there's so many different people on so many different sides of it, and there's even arguments about it in some conversations, and so I steer clear of that. I resonate with what I perceive as the archetype of shaman, and which is generally considered an indigenous person raised in a lineage and working with the earth and walking between the realms. And there's so much more to it that I focus on the magic of it, the ability to be connected with the earth, connected with the natural world in a way that resonates and supports us, especially in our modern lives, because we're not living as indigenous people in a tribe, in a village where we're supported to do what we consider shamanic work. So I bring it back to remembering the magic and the gifts that are within us. And I leave the bigger definitions to other people.
And you also talk about the idea of magic mm-hmm. being healing, being mm-hmm. magical,
mm-hmm.
because despite all the you know, medical advances and what we understand in psychology, I think we would be very hard pressed to really understand how somebody grows and heals right. from the difficulties and the traumas and the things that we're born with that kind of hold us down and restrain us. Mm-hmm. And but there's something magical in that process when we can feel more whole about ourselves, more authentic and feel more a sense of our place in this world.
I have often said if I waited for science to catch up with what I've experienced, I wouldn't be moving forward with what I'm doing. Science will get there when it chooses to get there. I've experienced so many things that science could never explain, and it's changed my life. And yes. I've seen it change the lives of other people, and magic is a great word for it. And to me, it also, sometimes people use the word miracle. To me, it's our natural, it's who we are. It's mm-hmm. our natural way. We just don't remember yet. So it seems miraculous or it seems magical. And to me, it's really who we naturally, intuitively, authentically are.
Yes, it's part of ourselves that we've lost.
Exactly.
Because the shaman is rooted in the indigenous culture mm-hmm. who, mm-hmm. Practiced these methods for 100,000 years, mm-hmm. And handed down from generation to generation and knew how, we're so closely connected to nature. Mm-hmm. And when I say nature too, I want to include both the visible, what we can perceive through our senses, and that which exists beyond our senses too, and the invisible realm. They knew about these things, and they knew how to tap into them in order to facilitate healing and wellness within their community.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. And I really feel that each of us, that's why I don't really go into the whole what is a shaman conversation too intensely with people. My experience is whatever archetype, whatever energy you choose to embody, call it in. Call in shaman, call in healer, call in teacher, call in dancer, call mm-hmm. in mother, call in sister, brother, community leader, and embody that and bring your medicine, bring your gifts in that way if it resonates for you. Not everyone resonates with the term shaman. Not everyone resonates with the term teacher. So find something that resonates for you and live into your gifts in that, because we all have the gifts. It's really just a matter of what we focus on. If I wanted to be a professional dancer and focused and studied and spend as much time on that as I do on the shamanic path, I might have been an okay dancer. I don't feel that I'm naturally gifted in that way, although I love to dance. But I've spent my focus and my heart calling on the shamanic path, so that's what resonates for me, and that's why I have these amazing experiences so often, because I'm putting the intention and the time into receiving.
Yeah, and you're saying there's, with every word, there's kind of an energetic resonance that goes with it, and that there's certain words that are evoked that can really touch a special place within us. There's something mm-hmm. heartfelt and meaningful about that, and it's important to pay attention to that.
Yes, and it can be something as simple as, when I was younger, I was very intimidated to dance if I went out dancing with friends, to dance in front of other people. So I simply started, I would go into the space wherever we were, the club, wherever we were, and I would say, I am a dancer. I am a dancer. I am a dancer. To myself, I wouldn't be standing there talking out loud in the middle of the club. Although, who knows, today I might do that. But I would say that to myself to the point that I thought, I am a dancer. Okay. And I would just start dancing. And it was incredible to me, the people who would respond in a positive way and come up and introduce themselves and connect in a really positive, heart-centered space, because that's the vibration I was bringing. Mm-hmm. And believe me, honey, I am not a dancer. I do what I do, but I start saying it, and I really believe that that's what I mean by calling it in. Someone said to me the other day, I have a hard time saving money. And I said, well, if you keep saying I have a hard time saving money, that story will be perpetuated. You will receive the story that you're vibrating out. And so he started saying, I'm great at saving money. That's his new mantra. I'm great at saving money. And just to watch his energy completely shift. Mm-hmm. He hasn't even seen the money happen yet. It's been 2 days. It's just a matter of the energy shifted. And so I trust that from now on, as he continues, if he continues with that process, he really is great at saving money. Our words are so powerful. And those unconscious things that we say to ourselves, oh, I look fat, or, oh, you know, whatever. If we're talking to ourselves with negative speak,
yes,
and especially when we don't realize it, we will affirm that in the world. Everywhere we go, we will see what we are, you know, writing, the story that we're writing. So being aware of the stories that we're writing, especially those unconscious loops going through our minds, something like, I'm not good at saving money, that becomes the story that we experience. So catching those, being intentional about rewriting that to something that feels good, even if we don't see it yet.
Right. It's because I'm going to say, what if he really isn't very good at saving money? And he's saying that, but there's a real mismatch in his behavior. Are you suggesting that by just beginning to kind of begin to see himself in a new light, that that's kind of the beginning steps of changing that behavior, that you start first with the belief, and then that can help you make you kind of, when you're about to make a choice about maybe spending something that you really don't need to, you're going to think twice because you're beginning to see yourself in a new way?
Perhaps, yes. It's also what I like to call a fake it till you make it.
Yes.
And one of my teachers just recently said, beyond the fake it till you make it is the trust. But in that moment of, I am great at saving money, he's shifted the vibration. So the clarity, those places that don't resonate with being great at saving money, will now start to rise up so that he can receive clarity and see where the non-alignment is so that he can change that. The clarity will come as we shift the vibration, because now the vibration of, I'm not good at saving money, it doesn't resonate anymore. We're changing that. And at the same time, it's often a habit. So when I say fake it till you make it, sometimes we say, I have plenty of money saved. I have plenty of money saved. I have money saved, until it actually starts to happen, because we've created this river of energy in this habit. And so in the physical world, it can sometimes take time to shift the flow of that river. However, if we keep saying, I can't save money, then the river has no opportunity to shift.
Right. You're just deepening that groove.
Right. So this is a way of stepping out of the groove, being conscious that we're stepping out of that habit and beginning those shifts. And yes, I do believe that healing and transformation can happen at the speed of thought. And as humans, we tend to make a decision, and then the third dimensional, the physical aspect, can take a minute to shift, or a month, or a year, or 10 years. It's okay. There are lessons in that. And I truly believe that as we become aware of the stories we're writing and shift those unconscious habits into intentional mantras, being intentional about it, then we really do shift things.
And one of the things about my understanding of the shamanic paradigm is, you know, we don't have to do this alone, that there's a lot of support and help for us. And many of it can come from places that have kind of one of many words to choose, the unseen world.
Mm-hmm.
And this really fascinates me, because unlike you, who seem to be easily able to tap into that, that's not been an easy, or something that it's just, I have a lot of evidence or experience to say, wow, that exists. What should we know about what is the unseen world? What's going on there? What have you discovered?
That's a great question.
I'm so curious.
What is going on there? What are they doing?
Because we just don't have any way to, like, for many of us, we just don't have any way to wrap our brain around this, because it's, you know, it's so, you know, just
it's so unseen.
So unseen, right. So unknown.
Yeah, and my experience
that's
has
so real.
Been the opposite. When I first studied with that very first shaman 15, 16 years ago, I was seeking to actually create some filters so that I wasn't constantly getting information from the realms, because I felt overwhelmed. Mm. And I sit with a lot of students and clients who are so intuitive and so empathic that they feel overwhelmed, even if they're not seeing things third dimensionally. And I really understand that experience. So he taught me how to create filters, as I would call it, energetic filters, so that I didn't have to constantly be barraged with information from other people's energy. I really feel that the simplest way to begin to tap in to the unseen, the realms, as I call it, is to take a minute and breathe into our bellies. We need to just stop. We've got to breathe into our bellies and be in our bodies and stop for a minute. How can we listen and hear that still small voice when we're running around busy, busy, busy all the time? So often we're receiving messages and we're not paying attention, or we receive the message and we blow it off as coincidence, or I just made that up in my imagination, or I think that was a dream, or, well, that was weird, and then we let it go. Sitting in nature, breathing into your belly, sitting on the earth, connecting, and just listen. Listen to the wind, listen to the birds, listen to the squirrels running by, and begin to really connect in with the earth and with the natural rhythms. As you do this, you will slow down and your energy will become more in sync with the natural rhythms. And then things can start to open up and you will begin to experience and feel and see in a new way. And it's so simple that I often feel that people don't realize it's happening. Sometimes you might see, maybe you threw your belt on the bed and you walk in the room and your belt looked like a snake for a minute. And you're like, oh, it's just my belt. Well, it looked like a snake. So pay attention. Snake medicine might be reaching out to get your attention. If you pay attention that it looked like a snake, 3 hours later, you might pass a snake as you're driving down the road and go, oh, there's another snake. Mm-hmm. And you start to notice the synchronicities. And the more we pay attention and notice the synchronicities, the more magical things become. But people go, oh, I saw a snake. Or they don't even look or pay attention. So they miss those simple synchronicities that start to open up the gates, the doorways to much bigger, broader, more expansive connection with the realms.
Mm-hmm. So it has to really start on that, just that simple, subtle level. And then from there, if we, like any discipline, we practice that it can grow over time.
It doesn't have to start there. That's a great place to start,
okay,
especially in our modern society. As I said, I sit with many people that feel so sensitive to the energies around them that it started whether they were paying attention or not, kind of like my childhood. However, like you, many people say, oh, I don't know who my guides are. I can't see. I can't hear. I don't know. And yes, those simple paying attention to the synchronicities and starting to notice and making a mental note and look and see. If you see a turtle, go look up turtle online and see what that information is bringing to you. Google symbolism of turtle. There might be something there. Start paying attention to the little everyday synchronicities, coincidences, magical events.
Things that capture your attention.
Yeah. Yeah.
That jump out at you.
And more will happen. The more you pay attention, the more you realize, oh, this is happening all the time, all the time. So it doesn't really faze me anymore. We drove up to Shining Rock a couple days ago to go hiking. And I went, oh, there's an eagle. Awesome. And then we kept driving. I went, oh, there's another eagle. Okay, that's cool. You know, I love it. I'm amazed. And it doesn't blow my mind in the same way that it used to, because now I expect to experience magic wherever I go.
Well, now there's a good belief to have.
And it works. It does work. And I will tell you, 15 years ago, I started saying to myself, my life is a spiritual adventure. And I was not living a spiritual adventure at that time. I had a very challenging experience through my teenage years and my 20s, and I did not want to even be on the planet, much less thought it was magical. And I started just saying, my life is a spiritual adventure. And now it really is. There was a point, though, where I had to start saying that and shifting from where I had been.
That's good. Good medicine, Bloom.
Thanks.
Well, you're listening to Living Well, and I'm your host, Dr. Bob Hanna. And we're going to take a short break and listen to a little funky music and come on back and continue our conversation with Bloom. So the song I got lined up for you today is I Know You Got Soul by Bobby Bird. Enjoy.
Rolling.
All right. Well, that was Bobby Bird and I Know You Got Soul. Welcome back to Asheville Free Media and Living Well. And I'm your host, Dr. Bob Hanna. And I'd like to do a public service announcement on behalf of Asheville Media, Free Media. This is for the Asheville Bike Recyclery. The Asheville Bike Recyclery is a nonprofit community bike space focusing on giving people the skills to build and maintain a sustainable form of transportation. Staff mechanics volunteer to teach any and all aspects of bicycle building in a hands-on learning environment. Learn how to maintain your bike or build a bike from recycled parts. Located below the French Broad Co-op, the recyclery is open to the public Tuesday through Thursday from 4 to 8 p.m. and on Saturday from 1 to 5 p.m. The recyclery operates on zero funding and exists solely through your donations of bicycles, bicycle parts, money, and time. For more information, visit them on Facebook at Asheville Bike Recyclery. Pedal on. Well, Bloom, I am so interested to ask you more about this idea of spirit guides.
Sure.
And, you know, sometimes you get this idea or a vision of an angelic being in your head. I mean, are these angels that we're talking about that are spirit guides, or how have you come to understand, you know, what a spirit guide is?
Well, people often ask me about, usually they ask about either angels or animal totems. So those are the two that come up the most. Really, my experience is that our guides are aspects of ourselves. So whatever you connect in with will be something that will resonate for you, and spirit will speak to us in a way that resonates. So many moons ago, when I first started shamanic journeying, I used to get scenes from movies. Like I'd see an angel from a movie or an animal from a film that I'd seen, because I love film. And spirit would use those images to get my attention because it resonated for me. And so at first I thought, oh, I shouldn't be thinking about a movie in a shamanic journey. And then I realized spirit is speaking to me in a way that I'll understand. And spirit speaks to us through our sacred imagination. When we're young, we'll often say, oh, I saw blah, blah, blah. I saw a fairy. I saw this. I saw that. And adults might say, oh, that's just in your imagination. And often we're unconsciously taught not to put any...
To discount it.
Yeah, yeah.
When exactly. Really you're saying that's a really important point of connection for
exactly.
Us.
Exactly. Our sacred imagination really is the place. That is where that powerful connection with spirit is so expansive and so creative, and so many of the images and the guidance comes from that space. So animal totems are very prevalent for people. Plant totems are very supportive. The tree tribe, I love the tree tribe. Angelic beings are beings of light, ancestors. Sometimes people have a strong connection with their ancestors and they'll feel that deceased grandparent or parent or great-grandparent walking with them. So for me, the simplest place to start with that I would encourage people is, especially since animal totems are so prevalent to the people who ask me this question, think about an animal that you have just always loved and adored. You know, as some people will say, oh, I've always loved horses, or I've always loved kangaroos, or I really like giraffes. I don't know why. Well, pay attention to that. Pay attention to why you collected teddy bears, you know, when you were a child and you have 15 or 25 of them now. Pay attention. I had a young woman sit in a circle with me who said, I don't know any of my animal totems. I just don't know who any of them are. And I said, what's an animal you really love? And she turned beet red and she didn't want to say. And finally she said, I really love hamsters and gerbils. And I said, that's beautiful medicine. Let's connect with hamster and gerbil and see what they're bringing you. And it was the sweetest connection with these animal totems.
Well, when you say connect, what happens there? Are we just kind of opening ourselves? I mean, how do we connect to that animal? So let's say, like I have a love for giraffes. Mm-hmm. So, as a few other animals too, but mm-hmm. giraffes certainly. My daughter was showing me this cartoon. It had a bunch of giraffes on it. She mm-hmm. says, "Oh, Daddy, I would probably give this card to you, you know, someday, because, you know, she knows I resonate with that. So how do I connect to the spirit of giraffe to see what it has to teach me?"
Sure. A great way is to start with the visual. Surround yourself with pictures of giraffe, or at least have one picture of giraffe. Bring a picture of a giraffe here to the studio and make an intention to connect in and be aware of that medicine that resonates for you. I also encourage people to shamanic journey. A shamanic journey can be as simple as sitting, closing your eyes, and visualizing a giraffe and beginning a conversation with that giraffe. If it feels silly, the sillier it feels, the more it will work. Trust
me. I gotta love the talking giraffe.
You gotta love it, because this really is about remembering what it's like to be a child. When you were 4 or 5, you probably would have talked to a giraffe and it would not have fazed you.
Absolutely.
And so what's the difference now? The difference is we've been conditioned not to do that. So shamanic journey and connecting in with magic is so much about remembering how to be a child again and mm-hmm. and believing that everything truly is possible. So closing your eyes and visualizing in your sacred imagination a giraffe. Talk to it. Ask it to take you places, to show you things. Ask it to bring you gifts. Ask it questions and see what happens. At first, you might feel silly. You might feel like you're making it up. And I will tell you, like I tell every single student that asks me, yes, you're totally making it up. Go from there. Start from a place of creating it in your imagination, and then it will begin to flow. And I like for people to start their shamanic journeys by going through some sort of doorway that they can close on the way back, just to keep the energy clear. And it's good to start in a space that feels resonant for you. See yourself in a forest or at the ocean or on a mountaintop. Visualize that in your mind and create the visual very clearly. Go ahead yes. and create it like a movie in your head so that you have a sacred space to start, and then ask giraffe to meet you there. Truly, the more you do it, the more it will just flow naturally. And you really will receive guidance and wisdom.
Yeah, that's I think the point that you're making is that when we do this process, that usually the message we get back is something that's affirming, that's something helpful, that's something that really speaks to us, that can inspire us to make changes in our lives, or to love more in our mm-hmm. world, or that usually those messages that come back are positive.
Usually they do empower us to live well.
Mm-hmm.
The farther you go on the path, your guides, just like any good teacher, will sometimes tough love.
Oh,
just like a good mom or dad. Mm-hmm. And so, yes, the messages in my experience are about empowerment and affirmation and empowering us to move forward in a good way. And sometimes we get to hear things we don't want to hear, and we always feel the truth of it. We always, you know, just like when someone says to you, "Well, it might be good to stop smoking cigarettes." And you think, "Yes, I know." You know, it's so obvious that that's the thing to do. So, yes, the information is very supportive. What I'd like for people to know is that it does take a little bit of practice, taking time to do it. Because when people sit with me and I take them on shamanic journeys and they have a really wonderful experience, and I send them home with the tools to do it themselves, they come back 3 or 4 weeks later and say, "Well, nothing happened." And I say, "Well, how many times did you shamanic journey?" "Once." "Well, okay, you know, try more than once." Because the more we do it, the more natural it becomes. And then there's no, truly at this point in my journey, I don't have to sit and go through a doorway and put all of that effort into it. I can, but I've done it so regularly and so much and have such a good time with it that it's just always available to me.
Yeah.
And I really believe that everybody can get there, where there's no more sense of duality and separation between those worlds, so that we can tap in whenever we need and always feel guided and supported and nurtured and looked after.
And another way, I want to give you an opportunity to talk about this, because I know it's mm-hmm. an important part of the work that you do too, as a ceremonialist
mm-hmm.
and bringing people together to perform ritual. I know we can do it alone or together as a group. But I imagine that this is another way to strengthen that connection to the spirit world too, and to that kind of spiritual muscle that we have. How have you come to understand ritual and ceremony and its importance in modern life?
That's a great question, and really so vital to creating a magical life and to living well, from my experience. Ritual can be done alone, and there are times when I feel called to sit by myself and create a ceremony for myself, because that's what I feel called to. And connecting with other people is so vital and so powerful, because when two or three are gathered together, you know, the energy is just amplified. And the more people that come with a common vision, a common intention, that group intention creates such a powerful energy, and the sacred hoop is created. And that, I really feel that all of us simply want to feel connected. We want to feel connected, whatever that means to each person. And ceremony is such a beautiful, intentional, supportive, empowering way to do that. We have rituals that we do all the time, unconsciously. If you get up every day at 6:30, and at 7 you're in the shower, and by 7:20 you're getting dressed, and at 7:45, you know, it may not be exactly those times, but people often have morning rituals, afternoon rituals, bedtime rituals, and we do this without even realizing it. So for me, it's about being intentional with our rituals, so that everything can truly be sacred, so that when we chop wood and carry water, there can be a meditative element to it, so that we're not walking around unconscious of what we're doing. You know, oh, I'm brushing my teeth. It doesn't mean you have to pray over your toothbrush necessarily, yet be aware that we always create rituals. So how can we create ritual that's intentional?
Mm-hmm. An opportunity to kind of bring into your life what you think will help bring meaning and joy to your life.
So that those common everyday chop wood, carry water moments are more magical. So that we're not walking around in a fog, unconscious, so that we're really feeling connected in each moment of the day. And ritual can be as simple as setting an intention and lighting a candle. It can be as extensive and expansive as going up to a mountaintop with a group of 20 people and setting out an altar space. And there's all sorts of things you can do. I highly encourage people to just take a moment and set an intention for the day. Take a minute and go outside and touch a tree, connect with the earth, breathe into your belly. Just taking a moment to stop and listen and breathe. Just start there. So many people say, I don't have time, I don't have time, I don't have time. Take 30 seconds. That's the beginning.
Yes.
And then take 3 minutes. And then take 5 minutes. The time will actually begin to show up and make itself available as we begin to make a little time. So even just a few minutes outside connecting with the earth, even in your yard or a tree that you really love or a park, go for a hike, especially in Asheville. We have so many places to do that.
Yes.
Making the time, because that's self-care. That really is self-care, and that's so vital. And that creates more spaciousness. And intention is what creates ritual. So really, ritual is as imaginative as each person. It's as big and as expansive and as much imagination as you bring to it. And it can be simple, it can be extensive, it can be short, it can be long. The intention is what really creates the ritual.
And just do it.
Just do it. Just take a minute, because you'll feel so good when you do. It really will shift the mundane to a more magical experience. And I just love that.
Now, I want to give you an opportunity to talk about the book that you wrote. Was that last year?
It came out in 2011.
And I want to give the name of it to our audience, Shaman's Toolbox, Practical Tools for Powerful Transformation.
Because so much of what is important to me to share with people is that there are practical, tangible, grounded ways to live a very magical, cosmic, amazing, expansive life, to walk a shamanic path, a spiritual path, an intentional journey. There are practical ways to do that and be very grounded. and really manifest in the third dimension from these tools. Mm-hmm. And in the book, I teach and share about shamanic journeying to connect with animal totems so that you can, I share it more extensively than we were able to get into today, how to connect with your animal totems and guides, plant totems. I talk about energetic protection, so there's energetic clarity for so many people who are empathic and intuitive and feel like they're taking on other people's stuff.
How not to be, which would be so great for many in the healing arts who are
so
actually
great.
Working to help people heal, and they have to sit with their energy.
Right.
And
how to
and
keep your energy clear and be really of support, holding space for other people, not taking on and feeling drained by it. I also talk in the book about past life work, a little bit about that. That's a whole other book into itself, but I do go into it and share how to do some of the work with the Akashic Records. And I also share about my story and how I came to this path and some of the magical, synchronistic experiences that I had on this path that kept me moving forward and learning and growing, so that it's not just a manual. There's also personal anecdotes in it to share with people, and it's a very fun, easy read that's also informative. It's meant to be a toolbox of sorts so that you can refer to it and do exactly the things we've been talking about today very simply, very easily, and starting with those simple beginnings. Believe me, that's where I started, and it has shifted and is so expansive and wide open now.
Yeah, so often you'll read books and it'd be very theoretical and it's really beautiful and moving, but it doesn't really present it's in a way that it's really tangible. We can touch it. Mm-hmm. There's a process that we can walk through and do, and it sounds like this is your gift that you've offered. And
it's so important to me, because for the first 29 years of my life, I didn't know what to do with it. I wasn't grounded. I didn't know how to be with all this cosmic energy, as I called it. And so empowering people to really remember their gifts, connect with their gifts, and what I would call their medicine, and bring their medicine to the world, whatever that is. You do not have to be a shaman. You do not even have to walk a shamanic path. These are tools that can empower whatever your journey is, whatever your heart calling is, whatever you choose to manifest, and really bringing that to me. What's the point in a mountaintop high experience if we can't integrate it into our daily life? It's a beautiful experience, and now we're back in the daily life. And how can I bring those beautiful, mystical mountaintop experiences into everyday life? That is when it really shifted for me. And that's why I like to keep it tangible and supportive and really helpful for people.
So if somebody has been moved, how can they get a copy of the book?
You can find my book on Amazon, Shaman's Toolbox by Bloom Post. You can also find it on Lulu.com. That's the self-publisher I used.
Okay.
So either of those. And I have copies if you're local. You can purchase them from me at workshops and circles, and if you come to sit in private sessions.
I was going to ask you, do you have some things coming up for that listeners might be able to tune into and be a part of?
Sure, I sure do. And I'm in Weaverville, so I'm outside of Asheville, where I teach is about 15 minutes outside of town. And I regularly host cacao ceremonies, which we talked a little bit before the interview. Cacao is the basis of chocolate, and I receive ceremonial grade cacao from Guatemala, and we have beautiful afternoon ceremonies with the cacao. There's more about that on my website. I offer what I call Medicina healing and activation circles. I'll have one of those coming up probably for the full moon this month, which I believe is the 12th. That'll be at 7:00 in the evening. A couple times a year, I'll offer shamanic Reiki trainings to empower people to really step onto their path as a healer and bring the shamanic aspect to it. I regularly offer private sessions, and there's more information about that on my website as well. And really, my website and my Facebook professional page, which is Bloom Post, are the best way to keep up with the offerings. I travel quite a bit and offer these circles in other areas as well. So those are just some of the more recent ones coming up.
Well, Bloom, thank you so much for joining
me
today, Olivia. Well, I just really so enjoyed today and all that you shared, and getting kind of inspired myself to get to know my giraffe guide just
yes,
a little bit better.
Yes, I'm excited for you too. Thank you so much for having me. This has been a real pleasure. Thanks, Bob.
Well, you've been listening to Living Well, and I'm your host, Dr. Bob Hanna, a psychologist and the founder of Integrative Therapy of Asheville. Living Well is underwritten by the West Village Market, located at 771 Haywood Road in the heart of West Asheville. West Village Market offers a deli bar with healthy sandwiches and soups, the Panther Moon Tea Bar, and the Pharmacy Juice and Tonic Bar. The market also carries fresh and local organic produce, an assortment of groceries and bulk foods, beer and wine, local products, as well as health and body care items. For more information, visit www.westvillagemarket.com. My next guest on Living Well will be Jerry Donahue, who is a communication coach who helps people learn to speak from their hearts with compassion using the model of nonviolent communication. And until next Monday, I wish my listeners a wonderful week of living well.
My name is Catherine. I'm going to be with you guys until 3 o'clock. Stick around. I've got a lot of new good music for y'all, but we're going to start off with an old one. The towers.